The Orion Arts Center's 2016 Dragon on the Lake Festival offered 4 days of fun for the whole family, highlighted by dragon boat races on the lake.
Dozens of vendors provided valuable information to those attending Orion Township's annual Senior Living Expo.
One local elementary school was the first school in the state to receive recognition for its innovative library program.
As Dream Cruise officially kicked off on August 19th, car buffs had some fun in Pontiac during Roadkill Nights.
Hello, I'm John Atwater.
And I'm Melissa Kratt.
We'll have those stories and more on this edition of ONTV News. As summer begins to wind down, area residents were invited to take part in one last big party. Lake Orion's biggest event of the year offered 4 days of family fun while benefiting a great cause. Things kicked off on the evening of Thursday, August 25th with a brand new event. Families were invited to come out for the first ever foam party set up in the Dragon Pub in downtown Lake Orion. The Dragon Pub is a large tent set up in the parking lot near the Orion Arts Center with vendors offering a variety of food and drink. The foam and music was provided by J. Sanborn Entertainment Company out of Bay City, Michigan. The company travels around the state and even to other states like New York to host foam parties.
With all of our shows, a lot of the things we try to do is provide everybody with a really good environment, a really fun time. Everybody comes out, they dance around in the foam, and everybody has a blast. I like to see things the next day online on Facebook and stuff about how much fun people have, and it's a lot of fun, especially with all the good food and stuff around too.
The foam party seemed to be a huge hit in downtown Lake Orion with dozens of partygoers of all ages dancing in the sudsy mess.
I thought it was super fun, and I've never been to something like it, so yeah, it was really fun.
It was a lot of fun, there was a lot of energy, and yeah.
Just rolling around, just trying to get as much foam as on me as possible.
I thought it was really fun, and just a lot of fun.
If you'd like to book a foam party of your own, you can contact J. Sanborn Entertainment Company by calling 989-684-0772, or visit djfun.com.
The fun continued on Friday night with several activities taking place on the shores of Lake Orion. Dragon on the Lake wouldn't be possible without the generous contributions from local businesses. The Orion Arts Center offered thanks to the event sponsors with food and beverages, as well as music provided by Sheila Landis and Rick Maddle. Costume characters from the Michigan Renaissance Festival mingled with attendees, and spectators enjoyed a thrilling jet ski show performed by local daredevils.
We have a lot of generous sponsors that donate money for Dragon on the Lake, so the sponsors are able to come out here tonight and enjoy food and drinks, and it's kind of a way of us saying thank you to them for their sponsorship for the event.
As the sun set on the lake, several boats flipped the switch for the annual lighted boat parade organized by the Lake Orion Lake Association. Participation was down this year, but a half dozen boats went all out with the decorations. With the popular fire-breathing dragons leading the way, the boat traveled around the lake to entertain spectators. Judges determined which of the boats were the best decorated, and cash prizes were awarded on Sunday, courtesy of Ray Sees and Lapeer. Coming in first place was Jason Steve and his crew for their spectacular Viking ship. Dragon on the Lake shifted into high gear on Saturday and Sunday with an art and crafts fair. And of course, the annual dragon boat races on the lake. ONTV's Joe Johnson was in the downtown area all weekend and brings us the highlights.
Things kicked off on the morning of Saturday, August 27th, when Dragon Boat Race Director Rob Cavanaugh unveiled Lake Orion's own Dragon Boat. Normally, the Dragon Boats that you see during the races are rented. Race organizers decided to take steps toward purchasing a boat, raising over $12,000 in 2 years to buy this state-of-the-art Dragon Boat.
This isn't going to be in the water anytime soon, right?
No, what we're doing is actually, the Orion Arts Center started this event the Dragon on the Lake and the Dragon Boat Racing, but we want the Art Center to focus on the arts here in Northern Oakland County. So we are establishing a Lake Orion Dragon Boat Association, who will, the nonprofit will take over the responsibility. The boat will be donated to the Lake Orion Dragon Boat Association, where then the protocols will be put in place on how to get the boat safely to and from the water and what the maintenance schedule will be on it. And also a rental fee that the teams, instead of buying their all individual boats, they can rent the boat, the paddles, the life jackets, everything, the differential GPS, collect the, you know, practice in the boat at their convenience on the weekends, and then build a better team.
The association still needs to raise funds for a trailer. Those who donated $100 were allowed to sign the hull. The long-term goal includes the purchase of additional boats and a boathouse in Greens Park. While that was going on, dozens of vendors lined up on the streets of downtown Lake Orion for the Made in the USA Arts and Crafts Fair. Visitors were able to shop for unique art pieces, including jewelry and even birdhouses. Merchants sold food and refreshments while artists demonstrated their skills in front of spectators, like these young, talented artists who took part in the Chalk Art Challenge on Broadway Street north of Flint Street, hoping for a share of $500 in cash prizes. Unfortunately, a thunderstorm rolled in later that afternoon, forcing vendors to close up shop early. But the skies cleared up later in the evening, and the crowd returned to the Dragon Pub to enjoy a performance by the always popular 80s tribute band Square Pegs. The group, decked out in 80s attire, got the crowd dancing to classic tunes by Blondie, Cyndi Lauper, Devo, and the Go-Go's, among others.
What keeps bringing you back to Dragon on the Lake?
Oh, it's the crowd and the people. It's so much fun. This is one of our favorite shows to do every year, and we're so happy to be asked back.
That's awesome. What kind of environment do you try to create tonight?
Anybody's welcome, and we just want people to have a good time and dance and be silly and have fun.
Hopefully the crowd didn't stay up too late, because most of them showed up at Greens Park early Sunday morning for the opening ceremony of the 7th annual Dragon Boat Races. After race director Rob Cavanaugh welcomed those in attendance, the first three teams were on the water pretty quickly. A total of 22 teams took part in this year's race, with some teams coming from out of state and even Canada. After all 22 teams competed in two heats, their times were added together to determine the seeding for the third heat. We had a chance to talk to some of the team captains after they returned to the dock.
We're the Wonder Broads from Windsor, Essex County, Ontario. We've come to this festival since the beginning. We love to support it. They're doing so much good work here, not only for the sport, but for cancer survivors around in Michigan. So we really appreciate it, and we're thrilled to be here.
It's just so fun. It's so much fun. The teamwork, the camaraderie, you know, kind of cheering each other on, giving tips and tricks, and, you know, just it's just fun.
It's really cool.
I met a great group of people.
It's fun. It's neat that it's a community event. A lot of us had friends and family stop by and join us, and just the atmosphere down here is really great.
So this is a beautiful team of beautiful women who are all runners.
Or walkers.
With playmakers up in the Lansing area who decided to give Dragon Boat a try for the very first time this summer. They came together and practiced twice a week for 10 weeks, and they learned to become pretty proficient paddlers. So we're just thrilled to be here. We've had a great fun day, and really excited for all the hard work paying off.
Amazing day. Team's been practicing together for about 12 months, and we just really gelled today. We actually all met this morning for the first time ever. I know these people, but this is the first time we pulled this group together. We had so much fun. The event's amazing. Great weather today.
Well, we all went around in between races and drank some beer and eat some barbecue. We carbed up. We made sure we got our energy up for the race, and just kept it together, kept it friendly, and just come out here and put all the effort in and work their butts off.
Actually, this team was kind of put together
just a mishmash of people. I made some phone calls, I begged, borrowed, and stole. So it's a great team, though, for our first year all together. I think we rock and rode.
Rock and rode!
Talk about the event, the atmosphere today.
Oh my gosh. I'm on the board of directors for Orion Art Center, so I can't say enough about how great this event is. It means a lot to the Art Center. And it means a lot to the community. I love seeing all these people out here. It's wonderful.
This event is by far my favorite event. I was talking to Chris earlier, and he was thanking us for coming out for a second year in a row. And I told him there was no choice, because all of my crew came up to me and they're like, "Are you getting the dragon boat ready? Are you getting the dragon boat ready?" Because it is so much fun. We're going to be doing it every year. There's nothing better than this event.
Another wonderful Dragon on the Lake. We had a great time participating. For us individually, the first run was a little slow, but after that, we were world class. It was a real fun time, and great to have this team.
Talk about this team. Who makes up this team?
Well, it's funny. We had a big turnover this year, so a lot of regulars from 51 North stepped up here, and boy, we're all friends for life now, I think, at this point. A lot of camaraderie is created very quickly in these boat races. It's a lot of fun.
In the final race of the day, the three teams with the best times went head-to-head to determine the 2016 Dragon Boat Race champion. In lane one, the Bernie Directive. In lane two, Your Ass is Dragon. And in lane three, on the right, Dragon Ass.
Couple boats going left and right, and now they're all centered, focused on the finish line. Focused on that finish line, and my goodness, it appears, if my eyes did not deceive me, that we had lane two, Your Ass is Dragon.
It was a photo finish, and the race announcer wasn't even sure who won. But when the official times were finally posted, it was revealed that the Bernie Directive team, led by Brian Bernie, was crowned the 2016 champion. Following the race, 2016's Dragon on the Lake wound down at the Dragon Pub with an award ceremony. Jason Steeb and his crew were called up to accept the trophy for best entry in Friday's Lighted Boat Parade. Orion Art Center Board President Yolanda Garfield announced the winner of the Chalk Art Challenge.
And the first prize for the adult with an original poem is for Flesh and Bone.
Each Dragon Boat team had a drummer to keep the paddlers in sync. The award for best drummer went to Team Dragon Ass. The award for best dressed Dragon Boat team went to Team Stronger Together for their zombie motif. The award for best team spirit went to the enthusiastic team of Rock and Row Dragons. And claiming the title of 2016 Dragon Boat Race Champion was first-time winner, the Bernie Directive.
Describe the satisfaction of finally getting over that hump.
Well, it was great, you know, because last year, yeah, there was a little bit of controversy, and we got eked out, and this year we were determined to come back full force. We had a few upgrades, but the majority of our team was still there, so we had that experience. And then, you know, we had a little bit of controversy this year just with the times, but they fixed it all out. They were very gracious and helped us out, you know, figuring out the times. So we got into those finals, and we said, hey, man, we made a stake to get in here. We got to win. So we did. It was a really close race. So we had the determination to get through at the very end. So it was pretty awesome.
What do you say about the people that were on the boat with you today?
Oh, well, it's a lot of family and close friends. So, you know, again, we have that synergy. And, you know, we're a very competitive family. We always want to come out on top. So we did today. And so we're really happy about that.
Of course, the Dragon Boat Races, as well as all the events that took place over the course of 4 days, acted as a fundraiser for the Orion Arts Center. It was the first Dragon on the Lake event for Executive Director Laureen Porter, who was hired in December of 2015.
It was almost a shock to watch how much effort and enthusiasm went into this festival. The Dragon on the Lake has been around for a while. This is my first one. So it's like, who knew how many people would work so diligently for both the Orion Art Center, because obviously we sponsor it, but at the same time, they were working for the community, and it just brought so many people together. It was great.
Yes, Orion Art Center, come take a class. We'll teach you how to throw clay.
The entire community came together to make Dragon on the Lake a success, including Orion Art Center board members, committee members, and sponsors. We asked event organizers to look back on the event.
It was a fantastic event. I mean, we had so many good teams come out. We know there are some teams that have been battling for second place for several years. They've been pushing to get to first, and it's made just a fun yet competitive community event, and really proud of the volunteers and all the paddlers that came out and donated their time and money to raise money for the Orion Art Center and the charities here today.
You know, a lot of people think that they have to be a fine artist, and that's not what it's about. It's about bringing something of your creativity, and that's what Dragon on the Lake is about, is being creative, finding that in imagination and maybe some dragons in there also. But that's really what I was happy about, is to see everybody come together, and that's what I love about Dragon on the Lake, and I think makes it a great community event, is there's something for everybody, whether it is, you know, the kids zone or a wrestling match, or there is art to look at and dragon boat racing. We try to really bring everybody that represents our whole community.
Anything like this, it's great to do it, but we can't do it without, of course, the volunteers, the employees of the Art Center, all the people from the community that pitch in and help out in so many different ways, the sponsors, the vendors, even like the team at ONTV. I mean, we need all the pieces to come together to be able to tell the complete story, and we can't do the big things that we want to try and be able to do for the community without all the people that do pitch in. So the more volunteers, the more we can do. We appreciate everybody that helps, and thank you, sponsors. Thank you.
The money raised during Dragon on the Lake helps the Art Center offer scholarships and classes throughout the year. For more information, visit orionartcenter.org or call 248-693-4986. In Lake Orion, this is Joe Johnson reporting for ONTV News.
Thanks, Joe. After undergoing renovations for 5 months, the Orion Center is back up to speed. Recently, the center hosted several events geared towards seniors. On Wednesday, August 17th, the Orion Center invited seniors to enjoy a picnic on the porch. Unfortunately, due to the extreme heat, the event was moved indoors. Entertainment was provided by the Paint Creek Boys, and the Orion Center served up lunch.
Hi gang, I'm Anna from the Orion Center, and today we're having picnic on the porch. It was a little too hot outside today, so we thought we'd bring the boys in. And as you can see, it was a great turnout. The guys are fantastic. We've had some awesome sponsors that helped us out with this event, like the Friends of Orion Senior, as well as Kathy Siebold Insurance and Independence. So come on and join us one time. We have food that we've ordered. We also did up some chicken ourselves to add to that plate, and we have some great food. So you should come and join us at one of our special events.
1 week later, on August 24th, Orion Township's Community Programs Department hosted the 2016 Senior Expo at the Orion Center. 37 vendors occupied the center's banquet rooms, offering a wide variety of information to visitors. The event was free to the public.
We have many vendors here, from American House to Independence Village. We have all kinds of things specifically for seniors. So if you're interested in knowing what to do with grandma who's moving into that mother-in-law suite, or you just need some information on healthcare, this is the place for you to be.
In the lower level of the Orion Center, Beaumont Health System invited seniors to take advantage of 13 different stations that tested everything from vision to blood pressure.
Well, we're doing the health screenings to combine with the vendors that have all the information upstairs. So, and we're able to do everything from blood pressure, vision, DEXA scan, osteoporosis, fall risk, memory issues, depression, sleep apnea, weight, BMI, anything. So they're able to come down here. It's all free, and they can go through 13 different stations. We put all the metrics on a sheet, and we have a raffle, so then we can encourage them to do a 77 tests for $70, a vascular test, it's free, and a free massage, so we want them to feel good too.
Beaumont has a presence at the Orion Center year-round. A staff person is on hand 20 hours per week to offer health checkups. Call the Orion Center at 248-391-0304, extension 305, for more information.
Throughout the state and across the country, schools are forced to do more with less as budgets are slashed. Recently, one local elementary school was recognized for its efforts to keep its library relevant. On Wednesday, August 24th, representatives of the Michigan Department of Education visited Carpenter Elementary to recognize the school for its innovative library. The newly created program, known as SL21 and Carpenter, was the very first school to receive the recognition.
I was shocked and surprised, I've got to say. About 2 or 3 minutes after I got the email, Adam Weldon, my principal, walked in and I showed it to him and I said, I'm not sure what we've gotten ourselves into. But it's been exciting and it's been good.
One of the things that's very important if they're going to be selected is the approach of seeing this learning experience as a community experience and understanding that what goes on in school has to leave the school walls and enter into the community, and that could be collaborations with other institutions, the local public library, the YMCA, whatever it may be. That's a big part. But the other thing that Carpenter did that was really significant when we were looking at it is their approach to teaching technology to kids and doing the team teaching, getting the school librarian out from behind a desk in the school library into the classroom side by side with the subject specialist teachers is really crucial, and the program they've established here is really noteworthy.
Well, if we want to become a top 10 state, there's some things we need to do. One is to have a love of reading and learning. One is to infuse technology in what we're doing, because that's what grabs kids' attention and their imagination. And so seeing that the kids are passionate about this and that they're involved in it is key. Also, as Randy said, the connection with the librarian and the teachers working together, designing the project, and then students doing a project-based. Instead of just sitting in class and learning, they're using technology, they're using textbooks, they're working in teams, they're working individually to learn. And I think kids learn better in those circumstances. So recently, Orion was named an exemplary school district, and these are some of the reasons why they were named an exemplary school district, because of the great things that are happening in the classrooms.
SL21 stands for School Libraries for the 21st Century. Carpenter was one of the many schools from across the state to apply for the honor and had to meet several benchmarks. Superintendent Marianne Giannopoulos told us that other Lake Orion schools have implemented similar programs.
Well, I'm very proud of our district, and I'm very proud to be the superintendent, and I'll tell you that this award is well deserved by Janine and Carpenter. And it is also representative of all of our libraries at the elementary level. But to get the state superintendent to come is pretty exciting. So the fact that he's here shows that this is really a very important honor to be the first library to receive this award. I think what was most important was his comment and the state librarian's comment that this is a model for other districts in the state, and we welcome anyone who wants to come and visit and find out why this was our library here was selected as the first model.
Other schools across the state are encouraged to contact Carpenter to arrange visits and learn more about their program. The phone number at Carpenter is 248-391-3500.
Street racing is illegal and dangerous, but for just one day, it was legal in Pontiac, and I was there to catch all the action.
I'm down here at the M1 Concourse celebrating Roadkill Nights and the Woodward Dream Cruise, where cars are actually racing on Woodward behind me. Check it out.
This is the second year of Roadkill Nights hosted by Dodge. Last year, drag racing was held at the Pontiac Silverdome, where an eighth of a mile track was constructed. This year it was held at the brand new M1 Concourse, and a full quarter mile drag strip was created on the famed Woodward Avenue. Richard Rawlings, host of Gas Monkey Garage, was excited to be back for a third year.
Oh, you know what? It's my third year up here. Last year we did race with the Roadkill guys. We had a good time, but this is as cool as it gets. I mean, it's a really, really large event, and I'm all about it. Oh, man, there's more drag racing, more hanging out, you know, all the thrill ride stuff. I mean, Dodge and Roadkill are throwing a hell of a party.
Richard Freiberger and Mike Finnegan are the hosts of the Motor Trend YouTube show, Roadkill. They were also excited to be back in Metro Detroit for this celebrated weekend.
This is our second year in a row doing our Roadkill Nights event here at, you know, in conjunction with the Dream Cruise. Well, we went to the Pontiac Silverdome for the Roadkill Nights event last year just because we knew there's so many gearheads in town around the Woodward Dream Cruise that we couldn't possibly fail by doing something to throw a party the night before. And we won. There was 10,000 people there last year, and we're expecting as many as 50 here this time.
Well, it was obvious. I mean, when you have that many people show up for, you know, drag racing in a parking lot, and this year we're doing it out on Woodward Avenue, I mean, this is a natural place to come hang out with people that are into hot rods.
Drag racing wasn't the only fun at the event. Spectators could hitch a ride in some of Dodge's brand new vehicles.
Let's go for a ride in a brand new Charger Hellcat.
The car show capped off the event, allowing anyone who registered to show off their most prized automobiles, like Danielle Armstrong and her parents' 1962 Chrysler 300.
This was my parents' first ever brand new car. They ordered it new in December of 1961. It's a 62 Chrysler 300. My dad ordered it with a 413, a 3-speed manual, and a 411 rear end. It was fast, so they decided it was going to be their race car. This car had a 426 drag Hemi at one point. It had a few different stage 2, a stage 3 max wedge. It ran one over 300 races in its race days. Almost had the National Hot Rod Association world record for time. It was 11:23 in the quarter mile.
So it was a drag race.
It was my mom and dad's race car. And my mom started driving it, and she would hardly ever let my dad anymore. So then they decided to keep the car forever. And we lost my dad in 1998. During the restoration, we just got the car back from the paint shop. And then my mom put it all back together. Yeah, and then we've lost my mom 3 years ago in July, and I promised her that I would take care of her baby for her, and I still have her name on the front license plate. My mom was Ann Armstrong. So Jack and Ann Armstrong, my mom and dad, this is why I drive this car. This is the original color. It's called Bermuda Turquoise, and my mom fell in love with it all those many years ago. But the paint job is about 20 years old, so it has been redone.
It doesn't look 20 years old.
Yeah, and it is a 4-speed, so you have to really drive this car.
Yeah.
Well, this is world-famous Big Daddy Don Garlitz. He was one of my childhood heroes, and definitely one of my parents were his biggest fan. And of course, Roger Lindemood with the Color Me Gone funny car, he was also friends with my mom and dad. So I'm very honored to have their signatures on this wonderful piece of history. What's likely to happen to this car is to be donated to a museum. I want to keep it just the way it is, and it's probably, you know, that way it might stay forever.
Michael Mansack was showing off his recently acquired Power Wagon.
It's a 1951 Power Wagon. I've owned it for about 9 months. It was retrofitted back in the day with a late 60s V8, so it has about 30 more horsepower than stock. Transmission with two synchros, which is a nice touch. Rewired it, put a winch on, working on all manner of stuff. But cooling system is definitely up to par with today's activities, so I'm very happy.
You know, I've not been able to take it off road, but I put about 1,500 miles on it commuting on a daily basis, about 20 miles each way.
So it just making sure I get all the bugs shaken out, doing a 200-mile one-way road trip in about a month. So going back out to Saugatuck, Douglas area. For a car show. And yesterday, fuel pump died on me in the middle of Detroit, so I'm glad it did it yesterday and not today or then. So I'm happy. It's failing at the very most convenient times for me. I was actually looking for a Ford F1 48 to 50 time frame, but then I saw this one on eBay, and I've been kind of looking at Power Wagons, didn't think I could afford one. This one was a really good price. It was, I think, just hacked up enough. The shop I got it from didn't want to bother doing a full resto on it, but the patina is perfect. Someone had already put in a V8, just slightly newer trans.
It's just all around a really nice driver. I think it would be a crime to do too much to the paint. I'm trying to protect the rust where I can, you know, treat it on the undersides and the hems, but at some point it's probably going to become irresponsible to leave it like it is, and then we'll see what goes from there. But for right now, I love the look, so I'm keeping it just like this.
Tim Kaniskis, the CEO of Dodge, was glad that Dodge could host the event for enthusiasts to enjoy all aspects of cars and drag racing.
It's an honor to have all these people come out to this event. We had 10,000 people last year. We're already over 10,000.
That's what?
A little bit after 2 o'clock in the afternoon. We're going to go till midnight tonight. Turnout's going to be amazing. Really, the key to it is this is not a Dodge event. This is an event for the enthusiasts. So everybody's welcome here. It's open to the public. It's free. And we're really seeing the passion that these people have for their cars.
Roadkill Nights was held on Friday, August 19th, and the Dream Cruise was held on Saturday, August 20th. John Atwater, reporting for ONTV News.
And with that, we'll wrap up this edition of ONTV News. On behalf of the hardworking staff, I'm John Atwater.
And I'm Melissa Kratt. Thanks for watching.